Good morning, everybody, and welcome to Wake Up Missoula. It's Friday. Are you excited for Friday? Because I'm excited for Friday. But unfortunately, the weather is looking a little cold for sure. But it's definitely a lot warmer than it has been the last couple days. I'll talk more about that later on. I got some news articles talking about Kettle House's expansion into the state of Montana, which is both local and state news. I got a lot of information in terms of what is going to be live streaming through MCAT. We have a bunch of live streaming events that are happening today and this weekend for you guys to enjoy. We got a new art clip. We got a bunch of new programming, but let's kind of get into it. So let's take a look at the weather. Currently, it is -9 outside. I know I'm laughing, but you know, it's Montana. Like, I'm so used to it. It's funny that, you know, it gets this cold still. Still hoping for global warming, but, you know, who knows. So today, your high is going to be about 12 degrees. Your low is going to be -7, but, of course, the negatives will go away throughout the weekend. And then by Martin Luther King Day on Monday, your high is going to be 24, and things will hopefully start warming up, but you can expect flurries to happen on Sunday. So if you guys are planning on being out and about this weekend, just take into effect that you might have to deal with some intense weather. But so let's talk about what you guys can do in terms of winter recreation. So at Whitefish Mountain Ski Resort, you have about 1 inch of fresh new powder in the last 72 hours to work with. There's 9 out of the 14 trails that are open. Big Sky Ski Resort, you have 18 inches in the last 72 hours. Doesn't look like any fresh new powder in the last 24 hours, but last 72 hours, you got plenty of snow. Blacktail Mountain Ski Area had 9 inches. Great Divide had 4. Snowball had 2 inches in the last 72 hours. Trenton Pass Ski Resort, Lost Trail, 14 inches. A lot of fresh powder in the teens, and of course a lot of those local areas here in Missoula and around surrounding areas like Discovery, you have about 6 inches in the area, but of course 5 of their 8 slopes are open. And you can get more information about whether or not there's enough snow on these slopes and which slopes are open on thesnow.com, and you can find out more about that and more. But let's dive into some of the news stories that have been kind of surrounding the area. And I just kind of got finished doing the news, just kind of like researching, trying to figure out what news I should talk about and what news really caught my eye. And this is something that really caught my eye off of the Billings Gazette, and I have a clip from the owner of Kettle House himself. But of course, it looks like Cold Smoke will be selling in Billings, Montana, from the Missoula-based brewing company to a statewide demand. The beer has become common in Missoula, but it's hard to distribute in the state because of the state law restrictions about 20,000 barrels. It's about so the idea is that if you're starting a brewery in the state of Montana right now, the laws are constantly changing because they're trying to evolve one way or another. But in the state of Montana, if you're starting a brewery and you want to sell beer in your brewery, you can only sell a cap at 10,000. So what the Kettle House did is they kind of opened 2 different breweries, and they were able to do 20,000, but they're only able to sell to like Bozeman, I think Helena maybe. I think they had to cancel one place because they just couldn't have the amount of supply in the Missoula area because Missoula drinks a lot of beer. Moving on, Tim O'Leary, founder, he spoke at Bonner Milltown Community Council meeting to talk about the new amphitheater and more. But of course, he's talking about how he, his business is growing and expanding. So I have a nice little clip for you guys as well. And here is Tim O'Leary.
In 2006, we put beer in a can and screwed up my life for the remainder. It was a good thing we created demand that we didn't know was there. We filled the demand that we didn't know was there, and it grew and grew. So we had to build a second brewery, which ended up on North First Street. I thought that'd be the last thing I ever did. And then we outgrew that, and so we needed a place where we couldn't get evicted from because we leased both of those facilities. And our mission is to match the quality of our beer to Montana's outdoor beauty and landscape and recreational opportunities. So,
all right, so that was Tim O'Leary just kind of talking about his business here and there. I didn't want to show too much of it because it's starting to sound a little bit more like a commercial, but it's but the main point of why I'm kind of telling this story is that Bonner is one of those places that a lot of businesses are moving to basically have a startup in business, just kind of like growth. Bonner in Montana, just east of Missoula, has a fairly large growth, kind of like an in-town boom that most people aren't noticing. And I have the opportunity to kind of notice some of the things and some of the changes that are happening in Bonner, because MCAT does a lot of community council meetings there in Bonner. And MCAT also would do other community council meetings as well. If you are a community in and around the surrounding Missoula County area and you want to have MCAT shoot your meetings, kind of like what I just showed there, you can contact us at MCAT@MCAT.org, or you can call us at 542-6228, otherwise known as 542-MCAT. Moving on, in the United States, with only 1 week away from his inauguration, President-elect Donald Trump, soon to be President Donald Trump, I'll just pause for effect. Okay, anyways, turns out his cabinet choices disagree with Trump on many issues, which could make Trump's promises difficult to, I guess, come by. A lot of the things he's promised during his campaigning and all that stuff may not come into effect, because his own cabinet may actually be a barrier in his candidacy. With folks being grilled on the Senate confirmation hearings, with here's an example: Alabama senators hearing stretching for over 2 days regardless of a GOP-controlled Senate, which Dems, if they had a majority-controlled Senate, they can actually delay cabinet hearings on their opposition party, but with it basically can be streamlined through the GOP if they wanted to, because it's a GOP cabinet, a GOP Senate, and a GOP House, so they can actually streamline it. But with a couple people, like this Alabama senator, it took 2 days of hearings to confirm this person. Defense Secretary nominee James Mattis on ties with Russia, and he's talking about he's the Defense Secretary nominee, and he's a general. So this is what he had to say: "My view is that the nations with allies thrive, and nations without allies don't." Mattis says, calling it the most successful military alliance probably in modern world history, maybe ever. So this is what he has to say in terms of, you know, working together with the Russian military. And there's a lot of slack for sure, because you know, like, there's a lot of bad blood, especially since the end of the Cold War. Doesn't mean that the Cold War remnants are still there. So anyways, this is, of course, one example of many of the cabinet hearings that will be going on. Up next, the two planned confirmation hearings for the past week were postponed. Education Secretary nominee Betsy DeVos will now testify Tuesday amid concerns over an incomplete ethics review and financial disclosures. The Senate Committee on Health, Education, Labor, and Pensions say that the delay was at the request of Senate leadership to accommodate Senate schedule. And I got this information from NPR News. So the cabinet will be going through hearings up until the inauguration, which will be next Friday. And that pretty much concludes all your news stuff for today. Let's throw it to where you can find out more information. You can go to NPR.org. You can go to the Billions Gazette. You can go to MCAT.org to find the meeting with Tim O'Leary from Kettle House, and of course many of the other things that are happening in Bonner by logging on to MCAT.org, going to our video on demand page. But let me just kind of guide you through our website, wakeupmissoula.wixsite.com/wakeupmissoula. So nice, we made you write all that stuff out, and I'm kind of too cheap to buy like the licensing for wakeupmissoula.com. You can go to, you can subscribe to us on YouTube, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. You can do those three different ways of following us on those three different platforms of social media. You log on to MCAT.org. You can totally like us, MCAT, on Facebook as well. I have local government meetings. I'll be talking more about that a little bit later. But on channel 189, you can see all the stuff that are going to be premiering on our channel on 189. Channel 190, we have a bunch of our government meetings on here. Local Live is a great source for you guys to check out any live streams that we may be doing, which this week we're doing it with Vibe. I'll have more information about that later. High school sports, it's one thing that I definitely want to highlight. It's the statewide wrestling tournament, and MCAT will be doing the finals Saturday, around 5-6 o'clock. So if you have a kid in Missoula that is a wrestler, they're going to be at Sentinel High School, and we're going to be attempting a live stream through Sentinel. But just between you and me, it really depends on whether or not we're able to get an internet connection. It's all about if we can get internet connection to our TriCaster system that will definitely need a Ethernet port. And a lot of times what we've done in the past, in this last year, is that we use cellular bonding, which is a little device that basically allows us to stream pretty much anywhere that has a cell service, which usually is like Verizon, because that's the strongest service in Missoula and surrounding areas. Not doing a commercial for them again. But of course, I have a bunch of brand new programs for you guys this week, and a couple old ones if you have been watching the, my show the last couple days. But here's a little taste of what you guys can see new on MCAT. And when we come back, we'll talk about, what are we going to talk about? Oh, we're going to do some pre-critic stuff. So there's a bunch of new movies coming out.
All I ever wanted was dinner, or at least his love. The delight I see in him is equally empty for anyone, and probably that's his stealth, inner lake. There's a car, a maroon, a colorless oval. I can imagine the seats and the feeling of hearing a song as we're weaving over hills. There's no break. Everybody I ever saw in my seacoast community is already facing the problems, huge and gloomy, I grant you, and the night spills on my keys, which are splayed over the counter, and outside it's light, and they are flipping their cards, every one of them.
Now, in the context of peasant agriculture in a place like Malawi, what might you think of as resilience? Ability to survive is very important, because a lot of these people live very close to the margin. Ability to survive when your maize crop fails. What do? And can somebody give me an idea on what you think they might do in the situation? These are farmers, the maize crop fails, what do?
What I've found is that I did 5 paintings 20 years ago, and at that time I'd been in the state about 20 years. And now the newer 5 paintings, I've been in the state over 4 decades. And so my experience of being a Montanan and sort of understanding where I'm living, certainly it was pretty good after 20 years, but it's even more developed now. So the paintings from 5 years ago, or 20 years ago, were inspired by historical events like Lewis and Clark's visit, you know, the Voyage of Discovery. That was going on. There was a big celebration when I was doing the paintings in the mid-90s. And Evelyn Cameron, there had been a book about her, so they were kind of recognizably important figures.
But and that's where we're trying to make the focus of our language retention, of our Nez Perce language. We have classes for adults, and hoping we can help them to where they can at least be able to be encouraged to speak to one another. Those classes are open to non-tribal people also, to non-Indians. And they seem to take a lot of care about faithfully following the lesson plans. And so some of them are a little more successful than our tribal students who are trying to relearn their language. And so, but it helps, because then they have to know how they can all work together.
No matter what you're planning, if you plan to drink, plan to have a friend get you home. Get ride home ideas and tools at plantolive.mt.gov.
A great day for me includes a walk outside with my wife.
My great day includes reading a good book.
A great day for me includes the morning crossword puzzle.
My great day includes playing the piano.
As you grow older, Missoula Aging Services can help direct your aging journey with a new Options for Better Aging program. Give them a call at 728-7682 to find out more.
Ooh.
Hey guys, welcome back to Wake Up Missoula. I just had to show a couple PSAs because I wasn't as prepared for this morning show as I have been in the last couple of them because I'm getting lazy. Moving on. So I have a bunch of, there's a bunch of new movies coming out, and what I always like to do every Friday is I like to prejudge them before I even know them. Just like, you know, you see someone walking down the street, like, I don't know, but I don't like him. Why not? And it's like, I just don't like it. And it's like, I just don't like it. Like this. Let's start off with America. If you don't see this movie, you're un-American. So get out of here. Get out of here. We don't want this kind of in our country. It's called Patriots Day, starring Mark Wahlberg as a cop in the city of Boston looking for a terrorist who bombed the Boston Marathon. Watch as he teams up with a symbolism of American grit and fortitude in this movie. Oh, the shoelaces. Yes, see? It's shoelaces. The poster of the American flag made from shoelaces. Very clever. Anyways, just a disclaimer, I have nothing against this movie, but for the segment, I do it for the sake of continuity for this pre-critic program. So if you want to see this, go see it. Moving on, Monster Truck. It's not about like a monster truck rally. It's about like a literal like monster truck. Okay, so from the makers of, you know how monster trucks are awesome? How about taking that literally and making them actual monster trucks? Monsters in trucks comes. This movie is Monster Trucks, starring a good-looking person who finds a creature kind of like E.T. who must avoid the government, kind of like E.T., impress the girl, kind of like Mork and Mindy, and win a competition race thing, kind of like Speed Racer. It's not really like anything else, but it's a cute little monster and his friends joining in the family monster movie. So, and of course, speaking of monster movies, we got The Bye-Bye Man. Doug Jones stars as The Bye-Bye Man, where he wears makeup for the umpteenth time in this psychological horror film about an evil ghost monster thing. The only way he can get you is to say or think his name, The Bye-Bye Man. Following along as we get another horror movie on Friday the 13th, because guess what? It is Friday the 13th today, and I'm assuming that the kid dies at the end, or if he doesn't, he goes cray-cray and is forever haunted by the Bye-Bye Man, or it's just like one of those like movies where just like everyone's just like kind of sitting around the table, and it's like everything's happy, and then he looks over, and like behind a tree you see the Bye-Bye Man. It's like, no! Or maybe it's like one of those like false scare movies where he's just like kind of looks over, it's like a guy in a hood, he's like, ugh! And he kind of takes off his head, he's like, gotcha! And he's like, that's, you jerk, you could have killed me! Anyways, it's about a surfer dude who wants to catch some waves and eat your soul. Have you guys seen Soul Surfer? It's pretty good, actually. It's actually pretty good. Live by Night, or I don't know. That's like a terrible like title. It's reversing. It's like reverse psychology. Okay. Fresh from the success of Batman v Superman comes a gritty noir with the Affleck duck. Yes, I had to make that joke because you know I'm old. Ben Affleck stars in this movie. Judging by what you saw in the trailer, Ben gets rich hanging out shooting. Shooting people and airboating across the bayou. It's based in the south around the bayou. I assume it's in Louisiana, but I'm kind of wasting time to figure out another crap movie about prohibition and the thugs who make money. It's just, you know, it's about prohibition. You know, you've seen that movie a couple times, and you know, you don't have to make it work. It doesn't have to work. You know, just because you should, like, after The Untouchables, it should have just, like, kind of, like, stopped from there. It's like, no more, like, oh, you know, it's the prohibition era. It was, you know, depression and all that stuff. And we should talk about the people who got rich taking advantage of people back in those days. Sure. Yeah. This movie's going to do well. So that concludes your daily dose of pre-critic. Moving on, I got a nice little art clip. Courtesy of the Historic Museum at Fort Missoula, and it talks all about the mercantile. So you guys can take a look at this, and then when we come back, I'll have all your events and all your stuff that are happening in Missoula right after this. Thank you. And of course, the Historic Museum at Fort Missoula is only going to get better with the opening of Fort Missoula Regional Park, which will be in late April. I don't know the date off the top of my hand, but I'll just throw a date at you. Just look around April 29th. Fort Missoula, the Historic Museum at Fort Missoula will be doing some tours around Fort Missoula itself while they have the grand opening for Fort Missoula Regional Park. So I definitely look forward to getting some footage from that and kind of showing you guys, but that's going to be in April, so that's a ways away. Let's see here. Oh, one. So let's just like skip. We're going to go right to events. I do have some city council. I'm going to save that for the end, but right now let's talk about some of the stuff that are happening here. Vibe is going to be happening at the Denison Theater. It's the Vienna International Ballet Experience. And it's been happening all week long, and MCAT's been live streaming it on MCAT.org. And once again, I will show you our wonderful website, MCAT.org. I'll zoom in a little bit. You go to Local Live. It'll bring you to this wonderful page. And all you got to do is you click on the little square. You hit play, and it will play the live stream. And there is no live stream currently because we won't live stream until right after this show at 9 a.m. and it's going to be going on until about 6 p.m., maybe 5 p.m. We might stop a couple times between breaks, and you can see the schedule at Rocky Mountain School of Ballet .org. I'm assuming it's .org. It's Rocky Mountain School of Ballet.org. Ballet company based here in Missoula, and they are hosting the Vibe event for the second year. I have a clip from the president of the Vienna International Ballet Experience. This is from last year, so if there's a little wording in there that might confuse you about it being the first year, it's not. This is the second year, and this is from last year's gala, which will be tomorrow night at 6:15 p.m. at the Wilma Theater.
How could I encourage young dancers to live their passion and also be able to transport their feelings and cultivate more their artistry? And I'm a little bit disappointed in general about the development in dance, because you can see so many nice gymnasts, but there are very few dancers out there. So that was my main focus for creating this Vienna International Ballet Experience. First of all, you realize I avoided the word competition in the name because I wanted it to be more. So I was thinking it would be nice to have first-class jury members working with the students. So we had our jury now here give workshops. I wanted them to get to the dancers know better. So it's not just the judging of the 1 or 2 minutes on stage, but to really get to know a little bit their personality, get to know them, how they work. So there's much more involved than just being here and judging and giving numbers. So also on our sheets, the jury members, they were given the numbers, plus also the name, because I wanted all the participants to have a personality and be acknowledged as artists.
That was Gregor Hatala, and he is president of the Vienna International Ballet Experience. And I think one of the things he told me when I got a chance to talk to him the other day is that he said that they're doing a dancing vibe experience for people who are physically and mentally disabled. And I think that is a great thing. And they're going to be premiering that during their Special Olympics in Austria. So that's going to happen. I believe that's going to happen this year. So just look for it. You can find out more information by going to Vibe International. That's the keyword. Here is some of your other events, but we're going to go back into events. Condoleezza Music and Dance Workshop and Gathering at the Missoula Senior Center. This is a big class, $20 per person per class. This is a world-renowned Condoleezza artist, I'm going to butcher this name, so just bear with me. Mabiba Bing will be teaching dance, drum, and song classes in Missoula from January 12th through the 14th. So if you missed yesterday, you can still check out today. It's a per dance thing. It's not like you don't need one to have the other. Unity Dance and Jump will help from Soft Landing of Missoula. Will host a gathering and potluck. Bring a dish to share if you wish to do so. From 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. Today as well, complete with African food, an informational dance, singing, presentations, and socializing to honor and welcome the newly resettled Condoleezza family. You'll need a ticket for this gathering, but it's free. And of course, the suggested donation is anywhere between $5 or more. And of course, you can get tickets at the door at the Senior Center, and the music and dance workshop and gathering is at 4:30. This event also happening throughout the weekend, which I'll get to it on Saturday. The U.S. premiere of Jumping Frames. This is a Vibe event. Vibe is sponsoring Jumping Frames. It is a film series from Hong Kong from director Raymond Wong. Its Q&A panel will take place before the film at 7 p.m., which will include Liu Bang Beijing Dance Academy, former ballerina with the National Ballet of China, and the director of Go Academy, and it is with the director, Raymond Wong. So this is a Vibe event, and it will be happening at the Roxy at 7 p.m. This is going to be it celebrates dance. It's a documentary, and it's all about the dance in China. And let's see. Let's talk about some of the Missoula Public Library events that are happening for Friday today. Tiny Tales is at the Missoula Public Library at 10:30 p.m. It's going to be either at the Large Meeting Room or the Dragon Rug, unless otherwise specified. You can guys check it out. They do finger plays. They do tell story time. It's just a fun way for kids to run around, be crazy, and just listen to some stories. And it's a great way to get them start reading and stuff like that. Family Story Time is also at 10:30 as well. I think these are for younger kids, still young kids. That's also at the same time. Yarns at the Missoula Public Library. Watercolor painting class is going to be at the Missoula Public Library at 12 p.m. Teen Writers Group is after school at 3:30 p.m. They have Worldwide Cinema. It's Thinking Money Edition at 7 p.m. at the Missoula Public Library. And that is all the Missoula Public Library events for your Friday. Here's all your music stuff to kind of keep you busy throughout your Friday. And starting off with some live music by Carla Green Jazz. And this is going to be at the 10 Spoon Winery and Vineyard. Tam Catmull will be playing at the Missoula Brewing Company at 6 p.m. We got at the VFW presents Charcoal Squids and New Old Furniture. And it's going to be rock music at VFW. Dead Hipster presents I Love the 90s. So if you love 90s music and you just want to reminisce about the 90s, you can go to the Badlander at 9 p.m. New Old Furniture is going to be – oh, they put it down twice. My bad. Money Penny is going to be at the Union Club. It's going to be miscellaneous music. So Gypsy Moon and Satsang will be at the Top Hat Lounge. It's going to be folk music at the Top Hat tonight at 10 p.m. Here are some of your events for your Saturday. For any hunters out there, MPG Ranch Winter Tracking and Campfire. This is going to be at Currents Aquatic Center starting tomorrow at 9 a.m. Learn to identify and track different animals in the Sapphire Mountains and along the floodplains of the Bitter River. After a morning tracking, they will retreat to warm campfires and hot drinks and treats. So if you want to find out more information, call at 721-7275, otherwise known as 721 Park. So you guys can check all that out. And this would be a good kind of like stone, a good way if you guys are interested in becoming hunters. You guys can kind of like learn how to track animals and all that stuff now. And then by the time the hunting season comes around next year, because by then the snow will come down as well, it's the perfect time just kind of like do hunting. And of course, what I want is I'm going to say this, and I'm not going to feel good about saying it, to the Bloodmobile. The Tempers Plaza Blood Drive at 10 a.m. The Bloodmobile will be at Joint Ace Hardware Albertsons. It's just off of Brook Streets. That's the Tremper Center in that area. It's Ace Hardware's, Albertsons, Paul's Pancake House, and the Book Exchange in Saving Limes at the Tempers Plaza Blood Drive on Saturday tomorrow from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. And you will receive discounts for Paul's Pancake House and the Book Exchange. For the first 10 donors, they will receive a $10 gift card to Albertsons. And you can go down and save lives tomorrow, even though it says today. There's a winter storytelling at Traveler's Rest, Perry Knees, or Knees, I don't know if the K is silent. Become immersed in the Rocky Mountain life as it was from 1825 to 1840, when trappers forged trails that American pioneers would later follow. Dressed as a woman time traveler from the period, Perry Neitz enhances the story with clothing, tools, horse tracks, and equipment from the area. And this is going to be at Traveler's Rest State Park tomorrow at 11 a.m. There's a Saturday Family Art Workshop at Starbush Brooks So it's a Starburst Books. It's at the Missoula Art Museum. It's starting tomorrow at 11, and it'll go until 12:30. Create a decorative book that bursts open, creating four places on each page for poems, drawing, jokes, press flowers, stamps, or whatever you want. It's a way, if you don't know how to make like a nice little collage type book thing, it'll show you how to do that. And of course, Saturday workshops are limited to 15 participants, so come a few minutes early to ensure a spot, and it starts at 11 a.m. tomorrow. So I think that'll be pretty fun for sure for anybody who wants to do that. And of let's see here. Family story time will be at the Missoula Public Library at 11 a.m. You guys can check that out. And that's pretty much it at the Missoula Public Library on Saturday. Here are some of your music events for your Saturday as well. It's the Loose String Band will be at the Missoula Brewing Company at 6 p.m. Cannon, Lockstock Cartel, and Miss Fortune Tellers will be at the Palace, because Palace is actually closing, and it's the basement of Golden Rose and Bad Letter Unit. They're going to be reopening as a pool hall soon, so they're going to be doing a lot of bands and a lot of like kickoff farewell shows to the Palace all month long. So you have Absolutely with Chris Moon at the Badlander at 9 p.m. tomorrow night. Corey Fay and Ovando will be in at the post at VFW. I know Corey Fay from college, and he's in the band. It's really good. Full Grown Men is going to be at the Union Club at 9:30 p.m. tomorrow night. Dodgy Mountain Men is at the Top Hat Lounge at 10 p.m. And I just want to throw it back to the Full Grown Men. They are a band that plays every first night in Missoula, and it's always nice to see them not there, because I always look forward to seeing them every year at the first night in Missoula, which is a New Year's event that happens, and it's great that they're going to be playing at the Union Club tomorrow night at 9:30 p.m. Just giving another post for them. Here is, and then of course there is one, I think I have one Sunday event for you guys. Oh yeah, one Sunday event. Here is, actually there's going to be two of them. Two Sunday events for you guys before I jump into some city council stuff. Historic Roundtable, Bonner Homemakers, and it's going to be at St. Anne Catholic Church. Glenn Max Smith describes the busy lives of Bonner homemakers in the 1950s and earlier. I have a clip also from that somewhere. No, I guess I don't. I wonder what happened to it. Oh, here it is. And here is a clip from one of those Bonner historical meetings. They only do this three times a month, so you guys got to check it out, and it's the history of the mill.
Well, the one thing I remember is in the springtime, probably just a little bit later than this, Leo Musburger would never let you go on the grass if you're going to leave footprints or scuff up the grass or whatever. And so the first time he would let us run around there, and of course, we'd take off our shoes so you could run faster, and that was always a big deal for the first few days that you could do that. But he always stood there and watched, because he didn't want you to tear up the grass.
All right, so that is one of many stories that will be presented at 2 p.m. at the St. Anne Catholic Church in Bonner. Of course, stories like this and more will be there. And the topic was what women did during the era while the men were at work at the mill, what the women would do at home. And I think it would be a very interesting talk, and this is done three times a year. And if you miss it, MCAT will film it and produce it and air it on MCAT, and I'll tell you when it'll air when it airs. Here's another one, Faces of Freedom, Voices to End Modern Slavery. And this is going to be at the Public House on Sunday at 5 p.m. I think this is very important. This event raises awareness about the realities and effects of human trafficking and other forms of violent oppression in the world today. Faces of Freedom celebrate the survivors, highlight our partners, ministries who rescue and restore, and present opportunities to engage in our audience. Faces of Freedom feature 14 original pieces of art carefully selected to speak to the theme of international plight of human trafficking. Some of the artists are from the surrounding Rocky Mountain states, and this is at the Public House. It's located at 130 East Broadway, Missoula. But of course, I can't talk about this weekend without talking about Martin Luther King Day, Martin Luther King Jr. Day. Empower Montana hosts their annual event. They were formerly NCBI. It's going to be at St. Paul Lutheran Church at 6 p.m. Following a youth rally at Karras Park that will start at 5 p.m. with a leader march around 5:30 in solidarity for days where we remember Martin Luther King Jr.'s efforts to break barriers between men and women of all walks of life. And it starts at 5 p.m. at Karras Park and continues at 6 p.m. at St. Paul's. And that's pretty much all you need to know about your events. All right, so moving on, it's time for some city council. So in city council, they were talking about things and stuff, like they do. The city purchase of Eco Compost at a sale price of $437,000 for the 3.04-acre property has been moving forward. This purchase was possible when wastewater treatment plant increased fees and rates in 2015 so they could do projects like this, not to mention that wastewater cut funding on heating costs in their facility because the gases that they created could generate the power that they needed to heat their facility. They are moving towards a more self-sustaining building from the natural gases that they create. Emily Bentley is excited about the additional property in terms of potential tree farm, nursery, and anything else that this lot of land will produce.
I'm really excited to hear about the nursery. We've sort of been kicking tires on it for years, and I think the first person who brought it up was, I don't remember. It was before I was on council. So I'm really glad to hear that that's a possibility. I'm hoping that as we move forward, if that really is the idea for this space, that we can capture the cost savings that we would have from purchasing trees. I think we get them in Washington. I know that those trees won't grow up for 10 or 15 years, but when we're looking at a huge expense, like reforesting the entire city, which essentially needs to happen, I think it was estimated at $80 million, it would be good to start really tracking these expenses and showing the cost savings from having to import trees that may or may not survive in Montana winters.
All right, so that was Emily Bentley talking about how excited she is for that 3 acres of land that are directly right next to the wastewater treatment plant, which purchased it. So it's an expansion of their property. One of the other quotes on there that I found, which was really interesting, was for the site that has composting for 40 years, according to Public Works Director John Wilson, it makes sense that trees and plant life would do well there. This item was put on the consent agenda. Here is a sidewalk improvement plan for Brooks, Stevens, and Mount across Hellgate High School. They also talk about this in Public Works. So they're going to be increasing a sidewalk improvement area. So if you're in these particular areas, they approved it and they will be working on it someday in the spring when construction season is in full swing. We got up next, we got some land use and planning. Our Missoula growth policy, just checking to see if I'm on camera, has set their sights on a North Side Scott Street District in the form of a urban renewal district to improve infrastructure. With many folks wanting better systems in place for our northern part and for our northern neighbors, and some concerns of money that would be greatly impact property and industrial sites. One thing is for sure is that the North Side is changing and probably more taxes. Chris Behan, he talks about the urban renewal district.
Attended. But I think it's important to mention that at this time we're not suggesting or recommending any zoning changes in the near future, so no one feels forced to do anything, because there's some controversy obviously here, because we're looking at and making some, we're presenting a vision here at this point of what we think this area could be in the future. We'll be wrong in some places, we'll be right in some places, but we need to be guiding this. And I think bringing in the police power of the city at this point, in a very broad fashion, would be counterproductive with a lot of the discussions we've had with landowners in the area. That said, there are some landowners that are not terribly pleased with the way we've even put this out, because their feeling is that they are kind of on the edge of the city. When I think that I would disagree, and I think that, that most of us here might disagree, that is an area that's under pressure right now, and their ability to continue their industrial activities is under pressure right now. And if we're able to through a planning mechanism, allow them to continue business and allow more homes to be built, more commercial activities to happen, more offices to be built in that area, do it in a safe and environmentally sound manner, we're in good shape because we've addressed all the entire spectrum of the kinds of jobs over there.
All right. So that was Chris Bean again talking about the importance of improving the North Side area, the Urban Renewal District idea. It's an idea. They're talking about it. They're making pre-plans before planning to make what's going to happen on the North Side. So it's kind of like a pre-plan of a plan. Okay, so the idea is to make a major change in the form of a new exit off of Interstate 90 that would go to the North Side Industrial District, because there's a lot of cars that basically get off at Van Buren. They actually have to go all the way to Reserve, go all the way around, because there's most of the ways that could get over the train tracks is Reserve Street, and they can't get it if they're coming from the east. But if they're coming from the west, it's fine. They can just get off Reserve, and then they go down. I think they just go down a bunch of streets here and there. But this way, it would streamline it directly from the highway to come off onto the industrial district, because there's a lot of industrial area on the north side near where the Missoula Cemetery is, and that's what they really want to do, is they want to solve that issue of avoiding that kind of stuff. Tom Zavitz, he's also with Crispian in the developmental area for this urban renewal district. He restates the use of this plan, and here he is.
It's a guideline for MRA and the city in making decisions on how to invest money in that area. And then it'll also be a guideline and a tool for landowners and potential developers that come into that area and need information. So it sets a long-term vision and illustrates some of the opportunities. As Chris said, it doesn't force change to happen. It's really designed to help implement change when and if it does happen. And
all right. So of course, basically, I've been restating this over and over again for this meeting. The meeting goes over some of the plans and ideas that many ways to improve the district, mainly to have an increase in commercial presence there, like, you know, cafes, maybe a couple stores here and there, because Northside is pretty limited. The Scott Street area is very limited to a gas station, a Thai restaurant, and I think they at one time they had like a marijuana distillery or something. I don't know, like for like medical marijuana. Just saying, because, you know, weed's not legal in Montana. I don't want to get into it. public hearing for this is on the 13th of February, where they're talking more about the North Side. So you guys can go on down to the meeting. And I do believe it's on a Monday in February. Moving on, Committee of the Whole. They're talking about mountain water acquisition again. But, of course, before I talk about the mountain water acquisition, they also interviewed a bunch of prospective replacements to Harlan Wells in City Council Chair Ward 2, one of two chairs in Ward 2 that they're going to be interviewing. I didn't want to show the interviews because showing interviews is kind of counterintuitive. It's kind of like, you know, if you want to watch it, you can go watch the Committee of the Whole at ci.missoula.mt.us. I will show you the website, and it will guide you to where I found these videos that I showed to you guys today. Here is council. Oh, so moving back, mountain water acquisition is being talked about yet again. Councillor Tasha Jones, who was on the prosecution side for the City of Missoula during condemnation and the hearing for setting a price, and it says that the city is on a tight time crunch and must acquire mountain water sooner than and also has to gather a bunch of information from customers that Mountain Water has that they have to release to the City of Missoula.
Best in the city's best interest to take possession now, and there's a number of reasons for that. In December, we moved the court for the court to supervise that transition because we want to be ready to serve our citizens on day one. and not just the citizens, but we want to be prepared for the employees so that they have their job set on day one, they get their paycheck on day one. And so we moved the court so that she could allow the transmission of information that would allow the city to prepare for that day. Our opponents, and we were asking for a number of things, but that the most important things were there were two things that were most important. Customer data. We want our customers to have no interruption in their service, to have a city that is responsive to their needs on day one. And to do that, we need customer data. Customer data is clearly a part of the condemned assets. And secondly, we wanted employee information. We needed information about each individual employee so that we can meet with those employees to structure their employment contracts going forward. There was opposition to that conveyance of information. Our opponents opposed the motion strenuously. In fact, Liberty filed an affidavit with the court saying they didn't think they needed to give us customer data at all, but if they did, they would just print it off and give us a box of paper.
All right, so that's kind of where the Mountain Water acquisition is at right now. Whether the information is gathered on time or not, there was a court order from Townsend herself saying that to Mountain Water Company that they have to release that information. And when a private company becomes a public utility, a lot of information becomes public. And that's just kind of like the transitional part of it. And there's a lot of kind of ideas that privacy is very important as well. But with like government, they have to be openly transparent. It's kind of like the folly of government versus what it once was with privacy. And a lot of the employees are not really happy about the transition into public utility, because if you're an employee at this public utility, which makes you a city employee of the government, which means that your wages are public knowledge, or basically you can see how much a person makes if you work in a public utility, kind of like wastewater treatment plant. You can find out who pays for what at what given time, and that's the transition from private Mountain Water Company to what it is now. Brian Van Losberg, he reflects and is hopeful that this transition will go smoothly.
My colleagues have all read the order. If you haven't, focusing on the good husbandry analysis that Tasha referenced, I think, is really worth your time in doing. And I was just really pleased to see such an unambiguous order to immediately, provide this information in the area of customer information and employee information. I will be interested to see the Supreme Court's response to the writ appeal. But as with all of the orders I think we've seen in this process, it's really straightforward, practical, marked by common sense, and unambiguous. And look forward to seeing compliance with it.
All right. So more on this. That's basically what's going on right now. The acquisition of Mountain Water Company is definitely getting closer and closer. And I'm sure it'll happen soon, because it was a court-ordered thing. Mountain Water's counselors, representatives, defense attorneys, they did it through the district court. They appealed to the state court, and the state's like, okay, relax. Just leave it back down at the district court. They can handle it. Then, of course, they're going up to the next court system, which is they already went past the Montana Supreme Court, so they're going to federal, trying to go to the Supreme Court of United States, and they're going to appeal to that. Of course, the Supreme Court has to look over a bunch of things here and there, and whether or not it's completely kind of like, so a lot of time, so it's going to happen. It's just taking a long time to actually happen. So that's what's going on with your City Council report, and I will kind of show you about how I get my information from City Council meetings and how I present it for you guys today. I do this once in a while, but I just kind of like want to reiterate this and more about how you can watch all these meetings at any time on the City of Missoula's website. It's ci.missoula.mt.us, so just think of City, Missoula, Montana, United States, and you're golden. You have the nice little webpage right here. I'm going to zoom in a little bit more. You go to your government, You scroll on down, you just look under City Council, because you're going to be looking for the City Council meetings. You go to Agendas, Webcasts, and Minutes, which are right, oop, your government, Agendas, Webcasts, Minutes. It'll bring you to this page. And this thing will come up after a couple seconds. It always loads, no matter how fast your internet is. It always loads. You can kind of see upcoming events, upcoming meetings, archived meetings, anything that has MP4, MP3 on there is something that you can watch and listen into. And it brings up a nice little area right here, kind of show you the list of stuff right here. You can see the video on the top right-hand corner where I showed you some of the video. Right here, you can see how each one has their own little hyperlink. If you click on it, it goes to that particular topic, courtesy of Marty Rabine, who basically makes those hyperlinks for you guys. And, of course, the city clerk does so much for the city of Missoula, and she can answer every question that you may ask of the city. You can get in contact with them by contacting the city of Missoula, and of course you can go to ci.missoula.mt.us. You can also go to Wake Up Missoula to find out more about me on Wake Up Missoula by logging on to wakeupmissoula.wixsite.com/wakeupmissoula. So nice we made you write it all like that. You can also Google Wake Up Missoula, and it will pretty much pop up this website and our all our social media stuff along with the videos. You can log on to MCAT.org to find a direct link to your most recent city council meeting. You can also watch any of our channels live on channel 189 or 190. And you can also look at some of our archived videos that I've kind of shown you a little taste of for your weekend. Without further ado, I want to thank you all for joining me this morning. I am constantly adjusting to my morning show to kind of adhere to one thing or another, trying to shorten certain things up and not talk for too long. So I'm just going to end the show. My Wednesday shows are very just like, here's a lot of videos. And then my Friday shows, here's a lot of talking. But without further ado, I hope you guys have a great week, and it's going to be cold. You may need to stay indoors, but if you're going to stay indoors, you can watch some Wake Up Missoula and some of our fun videos along with my stop motion anthology that promotes our Saturday drop-ins, which happen from 1 to 5 p.m. every single Saturday, every week, every Saturday, every single Saturday from 1 to 5 for kids aged 9-ish to 13-ish. We've had some 6-year-olds that are just perfectly cool just doing their own thing. It's a very fun thing to do. Kids get to learn how to make movies, get to make stop animation films, whiteboard, Legos, Play-Doh, all sorts of fun activities here. And of course, a little tease is that MCAT has a virtual reality thing now, and we're going to be getting that all set up and doing a nice little virtual reality thing, and hopefully have a more interactive virtual reality space taxi ride. So if you guys don't know what the space taxi ride is, a virtual reality it's a visual experience. We made a nice little large space taxi back in the day, but this way we're going to just have like a space taxi in VR form, just kind of give you the experience of what it's like to fly through outer space. And thanks for joining me and for Wake Up Missoula. I'm Scott Ramp, and you can get in contact with us at 542-6228, otherwise known as 542-MCAT, or you can email us, MCAT@MCAT.org. Thanks for joining me.